Hit it. There it is.
Hit it. What's up? Welcome to A Toy Kind of Moods. Welcome to the Terror Drome. And I'm here, Travis Moody, your host and co-host, Tony Romo. What's good, my man?
What's good, man? Having fun. Finally got Mark on. Hell yeah, it's going to be fun.
Yeah. Hell yeah. And speaking of finally having Mark2Design, Mark2Toys, Mark Gerwig, what's up, man?
How's it going? Glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's been in the work. I know like a year ago, I think we were talking about trying to have you on, but now
because it was seems like the Cobra convergence.
Mm-hmm. But we're here for some convergence on Mark2Design. We got a lot to talk about, so let's get to it. But for that, it's of course Payne's Toys Ambles at firsty. So we had to say what's up right there. What's going on?
What's up, Jerry Aaron?
Faust. Hello, hello, hello. And we'll check in with some more folks as they enter the chat room. But for now, let's get right to it, man. So it's kind of some not so secret origins. You've been making the podcast rounds as of late, Mark, and kind of talking about how you got into this game and what driven you. But the kind of the stuff I want to know that really appealed to me is especially I heard you were a lithographer. Want to talk about that? Because here's the thing. As an actor in Hollywood, there is always cast on casting networks. We need a lithographer. And I'm like, what the F is a lithographer? And why is this on every single day for a casting? So, hey, if you need some work, you might want to come out to LA and work a few days on set whenever we come back from the strike.
It seems like it's maybe not the same thing I did. So I was a lithographer in the Navy. Yeah. And that's running like a printing press.
Yeah, lithographer.
Yeah. So, yeah, I was at when I first enlisted in 96, I think. I was a lithographer's mate and got to do a couple years on the USS Kearsarge.
Nice.
Yeah. It's going back a ways. Was that AJ who talked to you about that? Or?
Oh, I'm not sure. I might have heard that on, like, well, you order a battle or one of your previous podcasts. Okay. Or something.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah,
it's always fascinating to hear what everyone does in the military because you know when in general everyone generalizes like oh it's a dude walking around with a gun, but to hear that you had like such a specific thing and here you are you're creating guns for military toys, so that's fantastic. But what is your connection from your Navy background to what you do now with military toys?
Yeah, well, After high school, I went to the Art Institute of Fort Lauderdale for 2 years, and I was in South Florida, and there's just like a bunch of art schools down there. There I wasn't finding the work I wanted. Working in the kitchen at Outback, and just started talking to somebody that had gotten out of the military, and I thought, you know, maybe I can just do that for a couple years, and so enlisted as a lithographer. I did it for 4 years and got out and was able to turn kind of that experience as doing desktop publishing and printing and got a job at a place called Avanti down in Miami. And then we did, we made the maps for Disney. We did all the ads and everything for like every cruise line, Party City. Anytime you get a newspaper that's got like a nasty Party City insert in it, we did those.
Oh yeah,
but yeah, there you go. You were doing some printing, and now obviously you're doing printing here, and then in other forms.
Yeah, after September 11th, I reenlisted, but as a cryptologist, and then that was a lot of stuff.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, you were kind of a Renaissance man in the Navy, from what I heard too, right? You just did so many things.
I had a really diverse career. I was a guy that wanted to deploy and wanted to try things, and kind of what they want you to do is not focus on one thing. They want you to learn a bunch of things so that eventually when you're in leadership, you have an understanding of kind of everything. And so I kind of leaned into that side. So I did a bit of everything.
Nice. I'm just checking in with some people. Thank you all for coming in. Awesome stuff. But and you were like an airborne operator as well, right?
Yeah, I did. Prior to that deployment, I was a ground operator. So I wasn't the guy that kicked in the door. I was the guy that waited for them to kick in the door and then came in and took charge. Yeah, that was good. Followed that up with airborne operations, where I basically, I got to be a little careful about it. I could, so I could talk like operators into a target. So remember, you've seen Black Hawk Down?
Oh, yeah.
There was those guys orbiting with the camera, and they were telling people where to go.
Right.
Yeah, I did that, except I didn't suck at it.
Nice, man. That's badass. So cool. Here we got a comment right here. I reviewed, is this Punk with Toys? What's up, Lawrence? I reviewed Mark's Cobra Asp that my buddy printed and gave to me. Really good stuff. And we'll
that's talk. That's right. He does have that one.
Yeah. We'll talk about that Asp. What's up, guys? What's up with Dodgy? So here's some other things about you that maybe people don't know. Like, you're really into horror. And I'm not a horror person. I don't know if Romo is, but if you have just something like your favorite horror movie or why haven't you done anything horror with your printing? Like, there you go.
I have plans. I have plans, and they're not going to be, I'm not going to be printing them.
There you go. Boom, boom. Yeah. Can you tell us your favorite like thing, either genre?
I mean, like 80s horror. Like, when I was a little kid, my parents didn't let me watch a lot of stuff, and we had this bus stop that was next to a video store. And so in the morning, especially in the winter when it was like 10 degrees out, we would go in the video store and just like peruse, and like I fell in love with the old video cassette boxes, and you know, reading the backs. And then eventually, once I was on my own, and I just really got into that stuff. I love that stuff. I'm going to Colorado Springs Comic Con this weekend, and I'm gonna go get myself an autograph from Sandra Peterson, Elvira. Very excited. I'm real excited for that.
Oh yeah.
I grew up in this town called Sycamore, Illinois. It was this cornfield west of Chicago, and it's kind of famous for having this thing called Pumpkin Fest. And so it's a big deal. If you're in Northern Illinois, you know what it is. And in the early 80s, she was supposed to come and be like the queen of the parade, and she was there. And I remember the dads, like the dad energy was like really excited, but the mom energy was like, get this bitch out of our town. And I think she just stayed in her car. She wasn't allowed to like get out of the car or some shit. So I'm gonna ask, when I see her, I'm gonna ask her about it. I'm curious if she, you know, maybe that happened to her 100 times and so she doesn't remember, or maybe she remembers. I don't know, but
I bet it she'll remember.
We'll see. I'm real excited to
I didn't know she was so tight and really good friends with Paul Rubens. Pee-wee. Oh, yeah. They were real tight. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, RIP right there. We're going to follow up and see what icon. She says for sure. What Elvira says for sure. Also, you're into metal music, and I'm on the surface metal. Like, if I name bands I like, you'd be like, that's some pop trash. You know how metal fans are.
I listen hardcore. To them. I have my favorites. I listen to a lot of stuff.
Good. What do you like?
You know, it depends on the mood I'm in. But like, I grew up in this cornfield, graduated from high school. Like a week later, I moved to Fort Lauderdale and went to art school and fell in with this super eclectic group of people. But like the dudes I was hanging with got me into Gwar and Slayer. And it's not really metal, but I love Caius. Jesus, the Testament. This is a whole show.
Like, hey, I'm glad you're.
Yeah, I remember all those.
I recognize. Because you know, some metal fans, they'll name like the 30 most underground metal fans and be like, you don't know about that, and they'll push it on to you till you die. So I'm like, I'm glad you're just naming people I've heard of.
Well, so I only recently found out about Prophets of Rage. Holy shit. Missed out on that a little bit.
Oh, I have like the is that like Rage Against the Machine? Oh, Tom Morello with Chuck D and yeah. Be Real and like yeah. Yeah, okay. Nice.
So right? There's just I have these gaps in my timeline where I was deployed someplace, you know, either there wasn't internet or, you know, like I did a couple of sub trips where like I literally disappeared from the face of the planet for a couple months at a time. And like things happen and you get back and no one's like, oh, by the way, this movie came and went and this TV show started, and like no one's like keeping track to fill you in on shit. So like years later you find out about a movie and you're like, when the fuck did this happen? And but yeah, I did a lot of deployments, so I missed a ton of stuff, and every once in a while I find out about something and just like, damn it.
Cool. Yeah, I'm a Pantera guy, Killswitch Engage, of course Metallica, you know. Yeah. Kind of surface level bands, but you know, I love that stuff. I just thought it was cool. I just kind of fascinate. So yeah, thank you, Chad, so much. Hit the like button. Really appreciate you guys. We got Mark. If you're just joining us now, we got Mark2Design. Don't worry, we're not gonna just talk horror and metal. We have lots of toys to talk about, but we want to get to know my guy right here. You know, he's been on a lot of shows lately, and they're kind of like, hey, let's talk about this, but let's know the man behind all this magic, right? So that's kind of what we go. And here's a, I don't know if you're a wrestling guy, but we lost a good one today. Terry Funk, man, he's going back. Let's go,
Terry Funk. Yeah.
Yeah, RAP Terry Funk. You got any thoughts on Terry? You know much about that wrestling, or you probably just so busy with the military stuff?
I pass.
All right, cool. There you go. Hey, easy enough. All right, let's move on. Romo, you had a. Actually, I have one more thing. So actually, I forgot to put this up. Oh. This was the fun. Yeah. I was like, this would be a fun getting to know our Cobra commander here. But yeah, this he's got. Oh, he's gonna show us.
Yeah, I got it.
Oh, look at that. That's badass.
Mark
man. Hit.
I got Mark.
That's accurate. That is accurate. That's perfect. That is far. I know you had good things to say about the selfie series last night. What's on your mind? So we won't dig deep into that too much. But how did this idea come about? Because I might have missed that part last night. How did this idea come out to make the sculpts for people? This was at JoeFest, right? You started making sculpts for people, different scales and everything.
Yeah, it was. I don't remember exactly what kicked it off. I had gotten a new iPhone, and there was a scanning app, and I just wanted to try it out, and it worked ish. But I was able to finagle it and make a couple of heads, and people really like it, caught people's attention pretty quick. But it wasn't what I was able to do wasn't good enough. I wasn't comfortable with it. There wasn't enough, like too much detail was lost. Yeah. So I knew if I was ever going to really kind of pursue that, I needed to find a way to manipulate those files and be able to put back in the detail that was lost. And it took me a while to work out the process. Mm-hmm. And then once I had the process worked out and started scanning people's head, I realized that process wasn't going to work anymore. So I had to readjust. Yeah, what I found was I practiced on some friends. I practiced on family. And nobody had like long hair past their shoulders when I did it. And when I started scanning people at JoeFest, it was like a number of wives and daughters and dudes with long hair. And like when I got back here to start working on it, like right out of the gate, the process didn't work because there was it was a mess. So gotcha. I had to kind of reinvent. Yeah.
Oh wow.
Mm-hmm. That's what's up. But one more thing I wanted to know about you though is that you're kind of somewhat of a gamer. Like you love mechs and like Mech Warrior Online, and there's this game that came out this week, or it's coming out this week, and it's Gamescom in Germany right now. The biggest video game convention in the world, and they just showed off this trailer. And I'm not like, I'm a Gundam person, but I don't know anything about this. But are you a fan of Armored Core? Because this game looks epic.
The first Armored Core, I had it on like the PlayStation 1. I was deployed to, I'd probably just in the med. I think we were just doing a med cruise. I was on the Kearsarge, and we had like this little 12-inch TV. And you could do two person versus in these robots. And as you play through the game, you unlock stuff and you build the robot you want. I got really good at Armored Core, and we would get like get about eight people gathered around this little 12-inch TV playing each other, just talking shit. And I love Armored Core. I loved that. Was a great game. And two was really good. Two kind of picked up where the first one left off, and then it got a little weird. Okay. So I haven't played it in a long time, but
Well, did you see the trailer for the Gamescom trailer for this one?
If there's a new one from this week, I haven't seen that, but I saw a trailer for it a couple months ago.
Okay. Yeah. So how are you feeling about this game? Because I'm curious myself. So I got to ask you, since you have a history with it now.
I don't have a console. I'm a PC guy, and I don't know that this will be on PC. And for me, like, I'm real busy, and I carve out a chunk of time most nights to play PUBG with a group of friends that I have. And for me, at this point in my life, and for the foreseeable future, gaming is a social thing, not so much a what the game is. It's more about who we get to play. And so when we lock onto a game and we play for that game for years, and it's really hard to get everybody to agree to move on to something. We'll try once in a while, and like one or two people will switch, and but not everybody. And it's a hassle trying to get like the group to move. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we played MechWarrior Online for years, and like we play every night for years, and we get good. And then we eventually moved on to PUBG, and we still kind of suck at that, but
it's still a thing. PUBG still a thing.
Still a thing. Yeah.
Nice.
The cheating is unbelievable.
So just to throw this in there, this game is for all the platforms and PC. So in case you do find some time. Yeah, it's a Bandai Namco or Gamescom. And then we got a comment here from DWH, our good friend. Dude, I was an old school MechWarrior PC game in the late 90s. I had the VR headset, the eyeglasses with the head tracker, and you move the upper part of the mech where you look. Good times.
That's awesome.
Crazy.
Yeah, that's very cool. All right, cool. All right, let's get into some cool stuff in addition to the metal, the video games, the horror. And that's, you were at JoeFest. I want to talk about that really quickly. We didn't get to really do a JoeFest show this year. We didn't get to go. We didn't really get to cover it. Things were too crazy. So just a quick tidbit on your time at JoeFest.
All right. So that's my 15-year-old son. He's, I think he's 6'1" now. A little punk.
Wow. That's taller than me now. Damn.
He's got I think his brother's 12. His brother's going to be 13 next month. He's the same height as me. Just animals. And I got my son to come help me at a couple of shows, and he kind of took to it. You know, he's really pretty shy, but like it's pretty cool. I've had a lot of luck with friends that are eager to come to shows with me and help me out. And it's I can talk about my stuff all day, and after they hear me do that, like they eventually start talking about my stuff with the same knowledge and passion that I have. And it's amazing. Awesome. It's kind of awesome.
That's great.
Yep. So, JoeFest. Yeah. You can see I've got the 1/12 scale, Freightliner up there. So it's Optimus Prime. It does not transform, but you can put figures in it. So you can, I have a bat driving.
That's crazy.
Especially right now with like the crossover stuff going on, it's almost like the perfect opportunity to have.
Yeah, I apologize already, but because I tell this story all the time, like I was gonna start doing action figure. Well, I'm still gonna do it, and I've still played with it. But so for action figure photography, I wanted to start recreating a real American hero comic book covers, and there's one with Lady J on a silver mirage, and she's kind of looking back, and there's
I got that one.
Truck coming behind her with a bat driving it, and you know, I was looking at the truck, and I'm like, that looks like a Freightliner. That could be Prime. So that's what got me to do that truck.
That's awesome.
And it was 8 days of printing on 3 different machines, FDM, and then it took me about a month of filler primer and Bondo and glazing putty and sanding and priming and sanding and glazing and sanding and sanding. And finally painting. It was a shitload of work to get it to the state that it's in.
We're gonna talk about that workload in a little bit, but go ahead, sir.
That you can kind of see the top of that MMS on the table. So I did that as a as like a live stream. Like, so we have the G.I. Joe 3D printing podcast that we do. We've got the Facebook group, and then we do a podcast about once a month, and one of the times, like, I live designed that thing, and all I had to go from was the blueprint. I didn't actually have, I never at that point had owned an MMS. So it's not perfect, but so I just brought it. I printed one, and it's that. It's right there on the table. I had more people asking about that damn MMS than anything else. And I finally sold it to somebody. I just got tired of people asking about it. Yeah, and then what? Like a couple weeks later, they announced that they've got the SMS.
Cobra SMS.
So that's coming too eventually, but.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Yeah,
like people wouldn't leave me alone about it. Like,
and that sucker on the table is 1/12 scale.
I think it's a terrible design. Not the MMS itself, but like mine that I did, the one that's sitting right there.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Just it's I don't know. I don't love it. If I had physically had one, I could have gotten a little closer. And then you know, I've got people watching me, and it's you know, the pressure's on to not take 10 hours, so it could be better.
For sure. For sure.
If you, with that glowing review, if you want, the file is online for free. You can download it.
Oh, yeah.
Nice. Well, I got to ask, do you enjoy JoeFest more or Assembly Required? This is Assembly Required. That's, I believe this is the one that's coming up.
Yeah.
November 3rd and 4th.
And I don't have like a favorite. Like I can't really pick between the two.
Hold on, Mark. Which one do you make more money at? That's more the most
important. JoeFest has way more traffic.
Okay.
That said, I have time to talk to people more at Assembly Required, and I can hear them because it's not as loud. They're just different more animals. They're just different.
Yeah, he says that he remembers he was there, my man, David. Thank you, David. You picked up that Joe Arcade for me and the Skeletron skateboard and stuff. He says he remembers the giant shark that I think you showed it last night. You got it with you?
Yeah, it's up. You want me to grab it?
I mean, why not? Is it hard? Is it hard to grab? If it is, you don't have to.
That's what she said. It's hard to grab.
So, yeah. That is what she said. So speaking of Assembly Required, you had it there. So yeah, it's like, and then here it is. The Chrome Shark is EPIC, says the Genghis Man. So
that's canopy. Mark wants to do a clear canopy, I heard.
Yeah. So eventually I'll redo it. I've got different machines now, so I can actually do a clear canopy now.
Nice. Next
time I do it. Like, so this one is all FDM. So next time, like, there's no, like, I will not have a printer large enough to do this whole thing in resin. The body will be FDM next time I make one, but the, like, the seats and the
crazy
stuff, like, that'll all be resin. Yeah. Time.
The safety. Hood is nuts. Yeah.
A lot of time.
Yeah. The canopy's crazy. Yeah. You couldn't redo it on that one, 'cause you'd have to break that one. Huh?
Woo! Yeah. The way it hooks in here is,
yeah,
pretty sturdy. I'd have to break that canopy off.
The damn thing's bigger than a freaking Sky Striker.
Oh yeah, it's bigger than a Sky Striker.
Yeah. So you have any big? It is pretty big. But you have any plans for? What are your plans for Assembly Required? Can you tell us, or is it too early? Do you have any like anything in mind?
So. Last year, they had reached out to me about they wanted to do these variant XMLRs, XMLRs, laser rifles. They really just wanted to use a file that I had on Thingiverse that they had downloaded, and I had done it so long ago that I'm no longer like proud of it, so I offered to just do that stuff for them. And that was great, and they were grateful, and I enjoyed it. So this year they did an online thing called Armor last weekend, and we did like a Crimson Guard set for that.
Nice.
So I do the 3D design, I send them the files, and then it's on them. And Travis, I think, does all the printing and produces that stuff, and then Brian does all.
A lot less workload right there. You're kind of just the producer of that. Yeah.
It's great not having to do the printing. It's real nice.
Well, you know what? I had a question for later, but I got to just ask you right now, because man, when it comes to like ideas and design, right? Mark2Design, you have it down pat, but I heard you talk about this on many other shows about the workload. Did you ever think of like maybe assembling a team to like someone could, and then maybe I don't know if it would be a crowdfund or kind of like a full-on website, a way to these things that people are begging you for at conventions, maybe getting them done, even if it's made to order, but having a hand. You have a studio, you know, is that something that's crossed your mind?
If I were to bring help in, I'd want to pay them appropriately, and the cost of everything is gonna really go up as a result of that. Sure, I could have more,
Oh,
but the costs are gonna go up a
that makes
lot.
sense. Yeah.
And as much as I'm 3D printing and selling this stuff, I still don't think it's the right way to do manufacturing. I mean, they call it additive manufacturing. I think it's great for rapid prototyping, but it's not. It's just injection molding is the way to go if you're really gonna go into it. And that's why I created Mark II toys and have the weapon sets. It was my way of trying to get into manufacturing and distancing myself from 3D printing. It didn't work, but I tried. I
Right,
mean,
and I think
it's not dead or anything, but it didn't move the way I expected it to. Like I can
right.
sell like the this eel harpoon gun on Etsy. It's $12 on Etsy. For $1 more, you can buy a set of eight injection molded guns that are, in my opinion, better quality. But the 3D prints still sell better than the molded stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's crazy.
And
Yeah, I think.
maybe it's, people want, when I designed the first two weapon sets, A and B, the market was a very different thing. Muzzle flashes weren't really a standard thing in any way, shape, or form. I'm not really a fan of removable magazines at this scale. Deco wasn't a requirement. So by the time I physically had product in hand, like the demand of the collectors was a little different. And I'm not attached to a brand either. So no one needs to have the things that I'm selling to like complete their collection.
That's exactly what I was gonna say, was something like this is iconic, right? And you're creating your own guns, which are beautiful and great, but people are like, where do I put these guns with? You know, like, if they're a big fan of you, or they hate those Nerf guns from your original Joes, then perfect. But like, I think people are more so seeking out the 80s vintage and retro to kind
Which
of
is
either complement the classified style or replace it.
yeah, and I tried to make, I have some stuff in there that I just there's like a P91 Bison in there, and that's the one. It looks like a grenade launcher, but it's really got like a helical drum magazine underneath. I love that thing. But I made sure, like the foul that if you do a ripcord, you want to have that gun. I tried to have one or two guns in each set that very much lined up with a G.I. Joe or some type of iconic like
Exactly.
action movie or something.
That's
Like
what we needed. And then people do those customs and stuff, and they don't have the gun for it. And there's Mark right there.
yeah, like like Airborne had that M4 with the adjustable stock and the bayonet. That's in one of my sets. The
Got
standard
it.
M16 is in one of my sets. Like tons of figures came with that, but you People, I get messages from people like, "Can you just sell me 30 of the M16s?" I'm like, "No, sorry." Yeah, so there's, I thought this, and it's not like they didn't sell, like they sold, like Big Bad Toy Store moved them.
Nice.
I still like, I still like take them to the post office every almost 4 times a week. I go to the post office and I'm shipping these
That's
things out.
pretty good.
So they're moving. They're moving, but they
Weapon
didn't
back, yeah.
expect them to.
We got a good comment here. The Bison was the Big Bear's designated rifle. So I think the thing is, you just can't market it as that, you know, otherwise, well, otherwise you get a cease and desist, you know, with your packs, I'm saying, with your Mark II toys.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. Like, if I was gonna get a cease and desist from somebody, I feel like it would have happened by now.
You would
You would have
already
got
got
it
it
already.
already. You would have got
it already. Fans like us, we look into his weapon packs and I'm like, oop, that's Airborne's. Oop, that's Ripcord's. Oh my
Right.
God. This,
Yeah.
you know what I mean? that's what you bank on, and that's what happened with me. I'm like,
educated, I got that
one because it has three of my custom rifles in there. Yeah. I gotta get that one too, because all you gotta do, they come all in gray. I can paint the hell out of them. So.
Yeah,
right. Fun. And then KJ brings up a good point, because I asked you about like maybe assembling a team so we could see more stuff, because of the, it just as a one man army, it just, like you said, it takes 40 hours just to do one part of something. So it's like, you know, and he brings up a good point. And then people would complain, because if you hired people, right, then you'd have to raise the cost of your stuff, and then they're gonna treat you the way they treat Gridiron. We're like, oh, why is the gun, you know, why is one gun, you know, $15, or why is this loadout $30? Yeah. It's because I also have a team.
And I don't know what their numbers are, but I suspect they're doing better than me, but they're not doing like Hasbro numbers, right?
Right.
Like,
no.
At the end of the day, if you're doing these smaller limited runs, even like 1,000 of something is a small run. Compared to the big toy companies, and if you're doing a small run, the cost is just going to be higher. It's a big part of the reason I haven't pulled the trigger on the next weapon set yet, because I don't think I want to do as big a number, and I want to have deco on it. I want to have things that require multiple parts, and I don't know that at a higher cost they're going to perform.
I got you. So we talked about all those other cons, and then there was PowerCon. Now, while you weren't there, there was a lot of product that you had your hands in. And if you want to just, we don't have any kind of slides or anything, but if you just want to quickly discuss some of the stuff that you had an impact with that was at PowerCon.
It's an interesting thing. So I had gotten out of the military not even 2 years ago now. And so this is like, I kind of decided to dabble and see if I can get into the toy industry. So like as a guy whose career in the toy industry is like a year and change old, I feel like even though like my contributions to a couple of these toy lines is really small, I feel like I'm making progress, you know?
Yeah. That's beautiful. 2 years ago, like you said, you just got out of the military 2 years ago, and now you have stuff with three or four companies at PowerCon. I think that's great.
So Action Force, and you know, they revealed, I did it. All my design work for 2024 got pushed off to Bobby months ago. So he revealed a bunch of that stuff. I'm particularly proud of, I think I mentioned this to you, like there's a flamethrower coming, and I did the flame effect for it. And I'm just really pleased with the flame effect.
In the panel, I think it was actually not, I didn't see the PowerCon panel, but I think it might've been JoeFest, where Bobby was talking about that fireball effect specifically. I think he was excited about that. Am I right or am I wrong with that? I think, I don't know, I'm trying to recall.
No, he didn't have it at JoeFest.
Okay, it wasn't at JoeFest. So it might have been something else, but I'm sure you had a hand in that too. So, yeah.
Yeah. So like the Action Force stuff, it kind of keeps getting better for me. What I tell people is I have like two states, right? Like I'm either getting better at something or I'm getting worse. So like as I keep going, I'm genuinely getting better. And I know, because I look at something I did a year ago and I'm like, oof, yikes. So there, but so there was the Action Force stuff. There's the Delta 17, the guy who's doing that, he reached out to me a little before Christmas last year, and I'm not sure what the story was, whether he just had more room in the mold, so he wanted some more accessories, or I'm not sure, but he had me do just had like a couple of guns for the Delta 17 line, which is gorgeous. I think it's getting kind of a lot of attention right now, because it's people are pretty impressed with what he's put together. And I think
our friend Ken from Toy Connections did a live stream over the weekend with Delta 17. He's very close to those creators, I believe.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah,
but go ahead,
I'll have to look into that. I'm really impressed by that line. And I had almost nothing to do with it. I did like three guns. But the line looks fantastic. So I'm thrilled to have, you know, at least had a little something in there. And then what is that? The Operation Monster Force.
Operation Monster Force. Yeah.
So Chris Scott, who's Grindhouse Toys, he hasn't been in the industry too long either. He's been doing a lot of paint masters for about a year now. So he, but he's awesome. He's crushing it. I love that guy. He's another big horror fan. nice. So he reached out to me and had me, he had some stuff that he was interested in trying to talk them into putting in the line. I believe that's how it went. So he had me do just like two or three things. I did like this very obviously customized, like assault rifle, like an M4 and a riot shield. And then, I did these stands, the stands for it are like gravestones. So it looks like a gravestone. You lay it down and it's the stand, which was, I think that was Chris's eye. It was Chris or Bill, the guy that's, Fresh Monkey Fiction.
Yeah.
A brilliant idea. Like they told me that and I was like, how has no one done that before? It just makes so much sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got, hold on.
You got it? Oh, nice.
All right. Yeah, I always test print everything
just for my own sanity. So yeah, it's like
that's crazy.
This doesn't have the pegs on it. I've got one with pegs, but they're pegs.
Oh, yeah. Right?
But yeah,
oh, that's crazy.
Yeah, it's just a good idea. I wish I had thought of it.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's like, so both you idea. And Gridiron are doing stuff with them, huh?
Yeah. Bill reached out because they're out there by you guys. They're West Coast guys.
Yeah.
So yeah, Bill and them got in touch, and their designs are fantastic. Like I'm not gonna try and say anything otherwise. They're doing great work. So
mm-hmm. Yeah. So in addition to what we have, this is, you know, can you believe how popular this was? Like on Etsy, is just like you said, the first batch sold out and it's going wild.
Yeah, I was a little surprised because I wasn't the first one to do it at all. I did it as a bit of an exercise. Like I was saying, like I'm either working and getting better or I'm not working and I'm getting worse. And sometimes I get stuck on things. And this was one of the things I was trying to explain, you know, just badly last night. I got really kind of hung up on some of the Operation Recall stuff that I'm doing. I really respect the hell out of the guys that they've assembled to do the Operation Recall stuff.
They're all legends, right? I mean, you got Ron Rudat.
And I'm getting, you know, and I'm getting designs from Ron Rudat, you know, designs to turn into a thing. And it's like, I really don't want to I want to make iconic stuff the way they did in the 80s. Like, look at that backpack right there, that scuba thing, right? You instantly know exactly what that is when you see it. And now I'm working with the guys that created that, and I need to be on par with them.
It's like, Mark, it's like you just got drafted to the Chicago Bulls or the Lakers, and Phil Jackson's setting up your first play in your first game, and you're the point guard, and you're like, I can't fuck up this triangle offense, or I'm screwed.
Like, who did I really trick to get into this position?
Who did you bamboozle to get in there?
Yeah. I guess Carson's the answer to that. But but no, I can do it. I need to kind of get over myself and just like own the thing that I'm doing. Which has been like the key to the success that I've had is just that I'm just like the stuff I'm making, I'm into it and I do it the way I want to do it. And I needed to kind of get out of my own head on that shit and get it done. I dragged my feet on a handful of things and sometimes I need to just step away and just do something easy to just get my head moving. And so that's what this was for me. This was like a playing basketball with a, you know, 6-year-old, just crushing them.
You had to know this was gonna fly.
What was that, Romo? Sorry.
Oh, I'm just saying you had to know this pack was gonna fly out of there.
I didn't think it would. Like, I haven't been paying attention to my Etsy store a lot. Like, I really hadn't even stocked it.
Oh, yeah.
Like weeks before JoeFest, I had to shut it down so I could just, you know, get stuff ready for JoeFest. And then I went from JoeFest, and then a week or two later, I had the DFW Joe show that I went to, Dallas-Fort Worth. And then I got back from that, and it's just like, I've got these head scans that I need to finish. I've got the Operation Recall stuff. I had to finish up the Marv So I just had all this work and wasn't paying attention to the Etsy store for a while. And I made this for me and I printed a bunch of extras and was like, you know what, I really should just put all this shit up on Etsy. And I did. And everything I put up sold out. The eel stuff I put up sold out in like an hour.
That's awesome. I gotta ask, does the we'll do a full screen so I can ask this question because I don't have it. I did order one from you, but of course, you know, I just did order it. So this will easily connect into the pack you'll have.
I have it. Here.
Oh, you got there. You go. You got one.
Yeah, because you can't see it when. Yeah, see, there it is, hooked in.
Yeah, you can. So like that little knob that's there, that's not how the original was. The original one's plugged straight into these pylons, whatever the hell they are.
Right.
But I didn't want to have the I didn't want to have them bent in a peculiar way that would wear them or make them break. So I created a natural spot for them to just.
Oh, great!
That was great. Hell yeah!
No, that's
nice. Yeah. You don't even notice
that iconic jetpack scuba pack. Jeez.
And the beautiful thing is, if you have three, you could have one with the OG pack as like the leader, right? And then just go with the, because these aren't too bad. They're just different. They're not retro.
They're not too bad. They got the logo on it and everything. But I need marks. You know, I had muchas gracias ones, and they're awesome, dude.
Yeah, and like that. This was the eel was definitely one of my like top five favorite action figures of all time. Period.
Exactly.
So for me, it was nice to have the OG stuff and the harpoon gun, like any G.I. Joe gun that had like a foregrip on it when I was a kid was it.
Yeah.
Cause they like the style, like nothing, usually the guns didn't sit quite right. But if you had it with a foregrip, like it looked just BA.
You were good. Yeah. Just with the swivel grip, the swivel arm and everything. It worked with the foregrip. I remember that.
Yeah. Like the Alley Viper gun, just the Viper, that assault rifle with the foregrip and the grenade launcher.
Yep, like the big long, the foregrip that looked like a magazine. You got two magazines? No, it's a foregrip.
Yeah.
Romo, I know you had a question, some questions for him. There was one that was similar to EEL. I mean, I have it in front of me, but you were curious about the throwback packs and weapons in the future. Romo, did you want to touch on that with Mark?
Yeah, since you're doing this, and you've done this in the past. I mean, I got the Megatron P-38 you made a long time ago, and the helmets and all that stuff. You're going to continue to make, you know, throwback weapons for future, you know, Hasbro stuff coming out, the future classified and whoever.
Yeah, I don't see any reason why not. You know, at the end of the day, I've never really done big numbers. Like, do you have the pack for him and the gun? The hair dryer. Do you know?
Oh yeah, I do.
So that's probably the thing I've sold the most of ever.
Really?
I believe so. And maybe 1,000 of those.
I'm gonna one up Travis real quick.
Yeah, I got you.
That's a nice Cobra Commander, man.
Oh yeah, thanks, dude. That's my custom Cobra Commander.
Yeah. Is that Molotow on the?
No, it's actually vinyl. You know, car wrap.
Yeah, nice.
Ryan Sweeney got me onto that, and I'm like, dude, I can wrap his head in that freaking chrome vinyl.
Yeah,
and, you know, he's actually a Spider-Man Noir buck.
Huh.
And then there's your pack.
Yeah.
There's your blow dryer.
Yeah. So I think that's the thing I believe that's the thing I sold the most of was that.
Really? That's crazy. So now he's got his sidearm, he's got Megatron, and he's got the blow dryer back there.
Yeah.
So there's my Coco.
Very nice. Like that whole thing is a Spider-Man Noir.
This whole thing is Spider-Man Noir. I was gonna make it from a Ghost Rider, but he had better boots. The Spider-Man Noir had better tactical military looking boots. Yeah. So I said, oh, that's a no-brainer right there.
Nice.
So I guess the question is, do you have any ideas for any? Have you, obviously you collect classified as we see in your background.
Yeah.
You see the slate coming in and you've seen the previews from their, you know, their fan first. Do you have any like ideas for any future packs for maybe some of the future classified figures coming out? Like, oh, I need to do this because they didn't.
It'll be something like especially like this eel thing. Like, I had to physically have an eel in hand before I could do this.
Like measurements.
You don't know where down the spine the peg hole.
The hole.
You don't know how deep it's going to be. You don't know how wide it's going to be. They're real inconsistent. So you could do most of a pack without the figure, but there's no way to make sure it's going to sit where it should and look right until you actually have the figure.
That's a great point. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm surprised you didn't even mess with a better harpoon gun, because these things are freaking spaghetti, dude. Oh my god.
Yeah, they're rough.
You didn't need to with their OG gun, I guess. You know what I mean?
Yeah, they're
mine luckily isn't that warped, but
we can fix it, heat them up, cool them off, make them rigid, but still, man. Once I get your loadout, that's all she wrote, and I gotta throw some paint on it and I'm good.
Yeah,
cool. I think it's vehicle time, and the Hydro-Sled connects to the eel, right? And everything. You want to talk about this one? This bad boy, you got one in hand?
Yeah, I have it right here. I got it when I was a kid, and I really remember getting it. And my brother got the devilfish, and I got this, and I remember feeling like I got screwed a little bit. But I got the eel like right after that. I got the eel and was happy because the eels and this thing go together. I guess Mindbender too, if you remember those.
Mm-hmm.
But
on the box.
Yeah, it's the Hydro Sled. This wasn't anyone's favorite thing. Like, no one was like, I hope I get the Hydro Sled for Christmas. But it worked. With the eels, it's great. And I was able to sharpen up some of the details on that. And
That's the epic looking.
Real nice. I'm trying to get away from like making my own water slide decals, and I'm actually having stickers made so I can get this nice white opaque. But it's a Hydro Sled.
It's so cool. Hey, if I got one for Christmas, I wouldn't be mad at all. It'd be a great Christmas.
I mean,
huge rocket, that huge missile on the side, when it fires, it's gonna spin that thing all the way around the water.
Yeah, and then they'll be like listing until they
right.
In my head, when I was a kid, it was an underwater thing.
Right. Oh yeah.
But that's not how it was. I don't know that it ever showed up in a comic, and I don't remember it in the cartoon.
I do remember it on the Battle of Cobra Island or something. I think it was, and Mindbender was on it.
But in the commercials, it was an eel, and it was Mindbender, who wasn't even laying down on it. He was like, he had his feet in where the arms were, and he was sitting on it. And that, it was like the devil fish in the Hydro Sled. But I had started it months ago as just like an exercise, like I was saying. And it was one of those things where at first glance, it looks real simple, but there's a couple of tricky bits, mostly along the back. I call that the dive plane, where it says no step, that red thing, forward to that, where it's got all those square holes. There's a lot of like little detail in there. It was a good little exercise, but I didn't finish it. And then the eel started showing up early, and I was like, I'll finish it.
Let's do it, right?
Thank you for showing up early.
Capitalize.
Yeah. That's so awesome. So I made these stickers. This was the first run, and like the two big stickers you can see in the middle. There's the one with the, who knows what those are? One, radar, sonar. I don't know what. But they're too big. So I made some changes to the designs, and I have more stickers coming. And so I'll sell the stickers, because I think I'm selling the file, and I get put the file up on my Patreon. And then once I've got the good stickers in hand, I'm going to sell some prints of that on the Etsy store if anyone wants it. But what we're looking at, the one on the left here is resin, and the one on the right is FDM.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Nice.
Yeah.
Wow. So speaking of difficulty, what was this is a Romo question. Romo, thank you, man. You gave us some great questions for the show tonight. What was the hardest vehicle you've had to make? What was the hardest one you had to print?
The shark, for sure.
That's what I thought.
the big thing with the shark is it's a lot of big pieces, and that's not so much the problem. But like I was experimenting with different filament. My initial thought was to try and find a filament that was the right color, and then just not even paint it. And the filament that I got, you know, because the shark wasn't white, it wasn't gray, it was like this weird off-white. It wasn't really eggshell. I don't know what color it was just weird. And excuse me, the filament that I bought for it was just trash, and it was just nasty, and it required to look even a little good. I really had to spend a lot of time cleaning that thing up, and that filament was just rough. So fortunately, my wife does most of that for me. So like the FDM printing, she does most of my FDM printing, which is fantastic.
That is fantastic. Yeah. We caught you, Romo. He thought he was off screen.
He got me putting away my Cobra Commander.
Putting away his toys. But
and not to make all of them fall down. Oh, geez.
Your friend Rolando checking in with you, I think.
Yeah, what up?
Welcome to the show. We got Mark2Design. We're talking about all kinds of things right now. We're talking vehicles. And man, this is the one you sent me, this graph, but we got a bunch of photos for it too. A few photos, but the ASP.
Yeah, the ASP was the tricky part about the ASP was that the original design really didn't have room in the cockpit for the figures. Like the original one, their feet stick out the front. You can barely close it. There's just not enough room in there. So like I had to modify it so that the figure could no shit fit inside. this was my first test print, and that one's still a little bit tight. So I adjusted a little bit after that.
Yeah, we could see the difference there. Yeah.
That Viper is stuck in there.
Yeah.
Mama, get me out of here.
It works, man. It works, man.
The you can kind of see it's like a hex. It's not really a diamond cut, but that texture that's on the base, once I put that in there, it like quadrupled the size of the file and got really sketchy to work with.
Oh wow.
So that was a pain in the ass, is what that was.
There's a lot of detail, rivets and lines and breakage and bending, and there's a lot here, man. A lot of angles.
I wanted it so I could do the Python Patrol.
Wow.
Because we were getting those Python Patrol figures, and the whole point of the figures in the back in the day was so they could sell us repainted vehicles.
Right.
So I wanted to do some of those. So in that vein, like one of my Patreon projects that I've been stalled on for like a month, I'm doing a Conquest, the X30. Oh,
yeah.
And it was 95% done. And like the next thing I needed to do was go in and put like the panel lines in. And when I put the panel lines on the wings, it corrupted them in such a way that I had to start over.
Oh my god.
Dude, yeah. We don't think of those things that you got to go through.
No. No.
Yeah, it's you know, and I use Fusion 360, which is not like, you know, it's not cheap software. It's an industry standard for a lot of things. And sometimes you can create a shape that's complex enough that when you go to alter it, the math is too much for the software, and it just says fuck you.
And that, right?
So yeah. So but I'm gonna get that finished here pretty soon and get a Conquest out there into the world.
Yeah. Do you think now at Comic-Con, obviously we got the Vamp and we got the SMS, and they promised, this was a question I had for the Hasbro team a year ago at Comic-Con, and then they fulfilled that fantasy a year later. Are you kind of going to wait and see maybe what they make, maybe what they don't make, and then step in and maybe be like, all right, maybe I will make this. You know, you're making the STL files, the print files, but maybe you'll make it for more people for availability if Hasbro's just not going to make it. Or what's your thought process behind that, you know?
I'm going to keep doing the files for people to print their own stuff. I really enjoy doing that. A lot of these, like these bigger items, just take up too much of my time, and I just don't have the time. So I'll make a couple of something, but the other part of it is once I complete a project, my brain moves on to the next one, and it's really hard to sit and just like keep doing the same thing. Like I've moved on. Like when I finish something and I get it sliced and it starts printing, if I know I'm not painting it, I'm already done and I'm doing the next
thing. You're done. Yeah. I got you. That's just me hoping because I don't print things. I don't paint things. Tony's the creator. I'm just hosting here. But
there's got to be a solution out there. I get a lot of questions like, hey, can you recommend someone to print this for me? I've gotten just burned too many times doing that. And I'd love to be able to say, call this guy, you know, email this guy. He's great. Blah, blah, blah.
Right.
That's
why I'm hoping like some kind of partnership happens. Cause not everyone has a 3D printer. Not everyone has the painting skills. Like we want this, but we also know Hasbro's and they're opening their mind to doing these things. So we may eventually get them anyway. Not that they're going to be better than this. I mean, these look one-to-one, right? But it's like, yeah, we still may, you know, I don't know. I'm just trying to find if there's an option for people that want to get them.
So then the other part of that is cost. So like you can get your files, whether it's from me or someone else, get your files legitimately.
Sure.
All right. That's number one. So for me, if it's like a Patreon exclusive, get on the Patreon. Mm-hmm. Your friend downloaded some stuff from some guy, like get those files, you know, like get your files.
Right.
Like, yeah. Cause people, what happens is it, like, there's a lot of, I'm not the only guy, right? Like there's a lot of other artists and, if people start printing and especially printing and selling stuff without someone's permission, they're just going to tighten that up and you're not going to get those files anymore.
They're screwing it up for us. Yeah.
Yeah. So get your files legitimately. And then there are legit, no shit, large businesses that do 3D printing. They're just not cheap. Mm-hmm. And what people want is free. And you got to kind of just wrap your head around the fact that that's just not how things are going to work.
Not how it works.
When I
Well, go ahead. I'll let you take this say, and then I got a good segue. But
here's my
right.
So when I did this, I didn't have a printer I could print this on.
Yeah.
I didn't want to do it in FDM because it's too much. It'd be too much cleanup. I didn't want to do it. So I paid $500 to have a company out of Chicago called Geometry print this this for me out of SLS. So you know, like
yeah.
I'm a printer and I still paid through the nose to get a decent print from somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that fair is pretty amazing. But you know what? You did make a vehicle that for you probably wasn't through the roof. And I gotta thank you, man, because I was able to review this on a Toy Kind of Mood or Terror Drome or one of these shows, and it is still a significant display in my collection. I just love it, man. You killed it. And then now you had I believe this was JoeFest, right? Was it?
Yeah, so it's sort of my 2023, you know, see me in person con exclusive was the Python. So the claw is an interesting one. It's gone through. I'm on my like version 6 or 7 of it right now, I've changed it. I started out with the landing gear, and I wanted to make it so that the landing gear actually folded up into the wings.
Right.
I got one of those made, and it was just like the materials, the 3D printing materials just weren't enough for it to kind of be survivable. So I moved away from them. I think the one you got is one I made a mold and cast out of resin. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I need new handlebars. My handlebars broke. Yeah.
Okay. You wonder. And like the handlebars are even a completely different design now.
Yeah,
like it's
that's why I waited.
More robust up there.
Yeah.
Oh, let me get you. I missed you on there. Did you guys do that again?
Yeah, I need new handlebars, and those are the ones I need. Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's sick. Crazy.
But but at the end of the day, even though these are thicker, right? Like if this thing falls off the shelf and it lands handlebar first, they're done.
That's what happened.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and usually it's somebody's cat. I've had three different people reach out to me like, "Can I get new handlebars? My cat."
That's me.
It's not the my sons need them anymore. It's my cat did it. That's the new excuse.
Yeah.
This is the problem, right? So he says, Lawrence. This says, my people ask my buddy to print stuff all the time, and then they ghost them, and they don't have the money. Yeah, like you said, the only price in the Joe community is free. So that's any community, right? Yeah, for sure. What else we got going on here? Oh, yeah. Okay, the Marv. How could I forget? Yeah, you sent us this image. Talk about it. Talk about the modular armored range vehicle.
Were you guys familiar with there's a 1/18 scale Marv, and it's kind of awesome. I had nothing to do with it. So this guy named Greg, he's got an online store called waywardgoat.com. And so he did a Kickstarter for the modular armored range vehicle. It comes in, I want to say it's like a desert tan, black, green, and like cobra blue. And the thing's awesome. It's fantastic. It's really good. And it's not like, I feel bad because I didn't back the Kickstarter, which didn't succeed. And then he just paid for it himself. I just didn't know. It's one of those things I just didn't know. And it's fucking fantastic. It's really good.
New to me too. Yeah,
that thing looks badass.
Dude. I'll grab one. Hold on 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Sorry.
I'd rather have that than the Vanguard.
We heard that.
You? What'd you
I don't
hear?
Know if Mark did though. I don't know if Mark heard that. Hopefully he didn't. But no, he can. Say it for the crowd.
I said, yeah. I'd rather have that than the Vanguard, baby.
I made the 240 Bravo for the Vanguard. Anyway.
Oh, did you? Nice. Yeah.
That's I was awesome. Like, Mark's going to no-sell that.
So, yeah, I haven't put this one together yet. So the wheels are in there. But I want to say it's like $55.
What?
It's
so I need that shit now.
I bought...
Look at that.
I bought two. But it's
from Wayward Goat?
It's so it's modular. So it's got different, you know, lights and guns and stuff that you can
Oh my god.
Yeah. So waywardgoat.com.
Oh my god.
And this is like for your 3 3/4, your 4-inch figures.
Yeah.
It's amazing. And especially like if you want to paint it, it's got the detail in there. You can paint the hell out of it.
Wait, hold up. That's 1/18? That thing's
1/18.
Massive. Yeah. Oh my god, because on the That's 1/18 because on the file you have it here. That
oh, it says 1/12. Yeah.
Right. So let me finish.
All right.
So
we're excited.
So Greg did the 1/18 one. He did the Kickstarter. He sells them on the website, and they're fantastic. The instant he got them in hand and started selling them was right before classifieds kind of kicked off, and a lot of us moved from like G.I. Joe is a 4-inch figure to it's a 6-inch figure. So as soon as he starts selling the 1/18 scale, people start asking for the 1/12 scale.
Yeah.
So he had to sell off his inventory, you know, but he's ready to start moving on it. So he reached out to me to scale it up from 1/18 to 1/12.
Yeah.
And so like, you know, updated the machine gun, updated some things around the vehicle. So it's not going to have as many little holes in it. It's a little less modular now. But like that, you know, we redid the turret, redid the hatch. There'll be a spot in the back where you can mount a gun in the back. Most of the work was done by the previous designer. And I just needed to update it.
Right. So we got a question. Was the Marv in G.I. Joe Retaliation? That's the sequel.
Movie? No.
No. No, it
was there a Marv type vehicle, a Marv type, I guess.
Yeah, there was probably like an MRAP type up armored 4-wheel vehicle in that movie. Sure. Yeah.
Oh. Right. I thought they just had that ripsaw tank thing.
No, I mean there was a couple of like armored looking vehicles in that movie. Yeah. But I don't know that there were ever any toys produced of there might have been actually. I'm not sure.
So are they making a 1/12 scale?
So it's likely going to be a Kickstarter. I know he's talking to the factory now to try and figure out pricing and what's doable. So we're probably looking at him doing a Kickstarter for it later this year, early next year.
Yeah, because that set, the set of 4 1/18 scales, $208. You get the blue one, the tan one, the black one, the gray one. That's crazy.
Oh, you looked it up? Yeah.
Yeah, $208. Like, it was $260. Now you can get it for $208 for all four of them.
It's really nice, and like the price, that's not bad. It's not a bad price, and it is. It's really nice.
Yeah, one of them's $55.25. That's pretty cool. Shit.
So, what would this run you?
We don't know yet. He, like I said, he's talking to the factory now. So I did the I updated it. They made the changes requested, and so now it's up to the factory and the engineers to decide like how much tooling going to be, how much will units cost, that kind of thing. That's where he's at. Like he's got to have numbers before he can start a Kickstarter.
Give a price.
So this is the Marv is a design collaboration basically on the 1/12 scale with you and in this company. Like I'm saying, you're not going to be like producing, but you helped him with like the design upscale.
Right. I would love to say it was a collaboration, but he essentially just hired me as a 3D artist to update the design.
Okay. You're a consultant. Nothing wrong with that. We love that. Sure.
I'm proud of it. Like it's awesome. I'm glad I got to, be part of it.
No, for sure. The thing is sweet. Yeah, we'll keep our eyes on that for that 1/12. Now yeah. I got room. Yeah. So now I get
it. When that Kickstarter goes, man, like it there's no reason to not blow the doors off of it, right?
Right.
This thing's it's pretty awesome.
Yeah. And people are fiending for anything 1/12, Joe, at this point. And then this was Operation Recall. You sent this to me. You want to go over this?
Yeah. So I assume most people know what Operation Recall was. So Carson Metaxas of 3D Joe's and the I'm trying to remember the name of the book.
The Art of Collecting G.I. Joe.
The Art of Collecting G.I. Joe. Something like that.
Oh, he's going to kill me. Anyway.
We'll back you up. We'll back you up.
So it during
the art. Ready? The Art of G.I. Joe, A Real American Hero, Omnibus.
Omnibus. That's what it was.
Yeah.
Omnibus. Yeah, it's an omnibus. We can't wait. To me, that's my most anticipated anything.
Me too.
Over the Dragonfly, over the His Tank. I just want that damn book. And now the update for those unaware, we got an email for those who backed it. It is hopefully going to arrive before Christmas. So that is like the perfect time because, as Christmas as kids, we had the JCPenney catalog, the Sears catalog, which Michael Mercy did like a whole hour and a half just going through a damn Sears catalog from like 86.
That's
so awesome. Imagine this thing if we get this in our front patio in time for the Christmas season. But yeah, go ahead.
So in the course of putting that book together and meeting the artists from the 80s that created A Real American Hero, they kind of did a little thing where he got them to create a figure based on something he created as a kid that he wanted to have as a G.I. Joe figure. And when it was done, Rotello, correct. And everyone kind of enjoyed that process so much, he decided to do a Kickstarter. He called it Operation Recall. And so, it's Mark Pennington and Ron Rudat and all these amazing, amazing, talented guys. And they're going to, create some new 1/18 scale O-ring figures. And I got pulled into it to do some 3D designing for the accessories, which makes it, the technology moved on from the way they're doing this. So being able to have me do some of this stuff as 3D models is going to really kind of help round things out.
Yep. And we have a question that has to do with this. Yes. 3djoes.com.
3djoes.
Go get 3djoes. That's it. 3djoes. And you can, I think you can still back the backer kit for the Operation Recall too. They extended that till next year, I believe.
I believe so. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
But, the whole thing is awesome. And I don't mean like because I'm doing anything. I mean
sure.
Ron Rudat designing figures and like they're sculpting them the way they did in the 80s. And it's amazing.
Yeah, he's doing like the bios and everything. It's fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah. Like he really got the old team back together, all of them. It's amazing. So
it's astonishing for sure. We also have this Manta. You showed this last night on What's on Joe's, but I don't know if you want to dig in a little deeper to this or at least
like we've got the that's funny. Facebook. Okay.
Facebook.
Yeah. No, so, you sent me that. I'm gonna put you on blast. I'm just Facebook. Kidding. I'm just
messing. So we've got the myself and a guy named Artoine Poor. Created the G.I. Joe 3D printing Facebook group, and we like he was doing his own thing, I was doing my own thing, and we realized there's probably a bunch of people that are doing this stuff in a vacuum, and let's get them together so we can, you know, trade secrets and talk. And so we created a Facebook group. We're up to about 4,000 members now. Wow. You know, we do a podcast once a month, and it's you know, we try to get a different guest on and we talk about different aspects of creating, you know, 3D prints, whether it's designing or printing or painting. There's a lot. There's a lot that goes into creating this stuff. Every once in a while, we do a live, like a live stream of designing a something. And I was talking to another guy that we pulled in to be an admin named Mike Kleppinger, who's awesome. He's, I want to say it's TechnoViper 3D on Instagram. And he does like these little models of Joe vehicles, and he always poses it next to like a dime or a quarter so you can see how small it is, and they're amazing, and the pictures never ever do it justice. Unfortunately, when you're photographing small prints, like it really kind of brings out, like if there's layer lines you're gonna see them, but like in person, in hand, the stuff he's doing is mind-blowing to me. It blows my mind. Anywho, do I have the date on here? No, I didn't put the date. What a knucklehead.
You right here. There you go, September 2nd.
So we're trying to, we don't want to do like a 9-hour live stream because screw that. But so we're trying to find something we could do in a reasonably small amount of time. So we settled on the Manta, thinking that'll be easy.
Right.
So we'll see. Hopefully three and a half, 4 hours, and we'll.
Yeah. We'll have fun to see like a live build of an item, right? So that's gonna be really cool.
And then when we do that, we put the file up on the Facebook group, and I'll put it up on Thingiverse.
Fantastic.
And so anybody can just download that for free, print it themselves, do whatever.
I still gotta go back and watch the episode where you had Sean Cho on there. I'm like, that was
fun. last Saturday.
Yeah.
Awesome.
He's awesome.
Fantastic.
He's fantastic.
Yeah. We did one.
Yeah, Giles Gifford uses him a lot. Yojo ARAH.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, he's great too. The doc.
Doc.
We did I want to say it was like the 1 year anniversary of the show or something. We just had a bunch of the people that contribute to the group a lot come on and talk about their own. We, you know, gave everyone like 10-15 minutes to talk about stuff they're working on and stuff they've done. Awesome. That is the best episode that we've done. So check that out for sure. And it's G.I. Joe 3D printing on YouTube.
Very cool.
So here's what I've made for the Manta so far. Ready?
Oh.
What?
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I had to find something I could make a sale with, so I'm kind of
excited. You're going to give one to Cobra Blue, too?
Might as well, right? That'd be easier. It'd just be blue.
Right? That's what they did back in the day, right?
Make more sense for like an aquatic camouflage than.
Or what was that? What was that glider they used? Remember that glider in the cartoon?
The Viper glider. Yeah,
the Viper glider.
That's one of the toys I actually had as a kid. Was that glider? Didn't know how good I had it.
I love that you're messing with the Conquest, because that was like the only big vehicle I could get as a kid. You know, I'm not Lawrence. I didn't have 10 flags. So
no, he's got one flag and like 50 shipwrecks.
No, I know. I just messed with them. We got a question here, a fan question. Are the sails made from plastic or fabric?
The original Manta is plastic. And oddly enough, it's like I've got two of them and they're in pretty good shape, so I don't know what plastic it is, but it's survivable. And it was more of a like an off, like a very light green off white, and then it had the you had the picture up a second ago, but it's got like the camo green is thicker at the bottom and lighter at the top. And it's actually really nice. And what I might do is find something I can do like an easy screen print to try and replicate that. Because that looks better than what I've got here for sure. But that doesn't, I'm never going to find fabric or anything that recreates that. I'm going to have to make it.
Nine shipwrecks. Get it rude. Get it right. Mood wreck.
Nine shipwrecks.
Non-biodegradable goodness. Non-biodegradable goodness. Yeah, there you go. Cool. Yeah. All right. So we got two more questions before we get into the community spotlight. One, I forgot to ask you earlier. Romo wanted to know, because you said the most difficult vehicle you made was the Shark, but what was your favorite? Of all the stuff we've showed today.
Oh, what vehicle is your most favorite that you want to attempt to print?
That I want to do? The Imp. The Imp. So for a chunk of my career, I was doing like counter proliferation of missiles. Anyway, the Imp is a tell. Just like the Rolling Thunder is a tell, that the what is that thing called? The blue, and it's got the two silver rockets with the red tips. You know what I'm talking about? Oh, that's gonna drive me crazy. It's a snake thing. Anyway, they're tells. They're transporter. Say again.
Give us a year.
Yeah, transporter erector launchers. That's what it is. And so, one of the first thing, like when I started dabbling poorly in 3D design, one of the first things I did was make alternate rockets for the back of the Imp. So instead of a rocket that drops mines, which is the dumbest thing ever, I did like a chemical rocket, a nuclear, and a biological weapon rocket. Yeah. And now I just want to just redo the whole thing in classified scale. So like the Imp was goofy. It had like the gun that's on it.
Crazy. I never even is that the one when they had those big circles around the missiles?
Yeah, like the missile would go and you pull it apart and like five little would fall and they're supposed to be mines. That's goofy. But the rest of it's solid.
I'm looking at it right now. That Imp is crazy. I never knew that existed, bro. I never knew that existed. It said 88, right? It came out in 88.
Yeah.
Is crazy. They've got a driver and then the missiles are launching right behind him.
See how big it looks there, but it's not.
Oh my God. Big.
It looks like it should be huge, right?
Yeah, it's like it's a mini Wolverine.
So when I do it, he'll be able to actually sit inside it. Because that's about as far down as he can go in the vehicle right there. So like I'll have a hatch so he can get inside and close the hatch. That gun that's on there is supposed to be a 50 cal. So I'll fix that. I'm going to put a windshield on it. And then I'll have like alternate and working tank treads, like tank treads, not a big rubber band, but individual treads, which is what I was talking to Sean Cho about on Saturday. That was
really? I gotta watch.
That was the whole reason I had him on to talk about tank treads was because I want to do them on the Imp. So it was a completely self-serving, selfish.
Dang it, Moody.
No, my God, good.
Yeah. So I'm looking forward to that one. But it's when I do it, it's gonna be for my Patreon. So if you want the files to print, that's where you're gonna have to go to get them. I'll make a couple. I might sell a few. I don't know. I don't know what I'm gonna do. But it's good. It's
question I had, man. That might be dead to
him. So I've got a lot of stuff. What am I doing? I have a Rolling Thunder I started like a year ago that I need to finish, and I ran it the same thing I was talking about with the Conquest. I got to a point with it where I went to make a change and it was and just like corrupted like half the damn vehicle. So I had to go back and kind of, the truth is like when that happens and I go and I start over, it's actually really fast because I've already done it once.
Already done it, yeah.
Like mentally, it's like just like fuck. Mm-hmm. And it's just really hard to go do. So I've got a Thunder Machine. Actually got my dad. I don't have one here, but like on the Thunder Machine, like the police lights were like stickers. Like I have blinking LEDs that are going to be circuit board. I got my dad to like design a circuit board so I could control all the lights on it. So Dang. I've got that coming, the Conquest, and I'm doing a mask Condor, the motorcycle. Yeah.
The motorcycle helicopter.
Yeah. It hung me up for a while. I was playing with how to do the propellers. So
very interesting. Where's KJ at in the trap?
So hold on. Remember we were gonna do we were gonna do a wish list at the end of the episode. Well, Bobby, one of the hosts of a toy kind of mood, gave me this. Oh, right. Oh, why is it not working? Oh, here we go.
No shit.
Ask Mark to make one of these.
And there you go, buddy.
Yeah, no, it's 90% done for weeks. This was the fucked up part was this easy as hell to design, but none of the 3D printing materials I found will do that more than like three times before they break.
Bend, yeah.
So what I've got is, and everything's for 6-inch figures. Like I'm trying to just stay there to not confuse people. So it's huge, but these become so thick. I have a slider that's inside it. So when you rotate it up on a hinge and then just push a little slider in to keep it in place.
There you go. Nice.
Yeah. I'd rather have this, but I can't inject plastic like that. I tried molding like two-part resin, a couple different resins, and none of it works.
Mask vehicle.
You want to answer this question?
Oh, gosh.
Who? Okay. One second.
He's got visuals for everything.
I know. Any chance you'd rather just print out the cockpit fuselage section of the Conquest covering the seat? It's just for display.
I'm sure they did it for 12 inch.
Okay.
Cool.
Your six pack. Good question. Every time you guys get a question that makes out of a seat is a good thing.
As I make stuff, because it's so big, like I kind of test print things in parts. So I've got like the nose section.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. No, it doesn't want to go in there because I'm
unquit. Oh my god.
Yeah. Anyway, so I've got that front part there.
Yeah.
I've got my cockpit part.
Ooh.
Like when I finish the whole thing, if you want to just chop it and do just that part, you're welcome to do so.
I gotta make a slipstream now.
I was going to ask you to bring it to assembly required, but I don't know how you get a plane on a plane, right? So
I have too much stuff to fly.
Yeah, exactly. All right. So I guess as a custom-based show, obviously this whole thing is custom, right? I mean, even though it's professionally done, what is your thoughts on the custom community, the custom classified community, customs? Like, are you a fan? Do you follow it? Do you tinker with your own figures? Like, what's up? How your feelings on the overall G.I. Joe classified community?
I think I've done one custom figure. I have like a huge list of stuff I want to do, but I've only ever done one actual custom figure. And it was, I made a Tiger Force Flint to put on the for assembly required last year because I did a Tiger Paw. So I Tiger Force Flint to put on it.
I remember that Tiger Paw, man.
Woo! Yep.
Yeah. It turned out nice. It turned out really good. I mean, at the end of the day, like the customizing community are the guys that have supported me. Those are the guys that have got on the Etsy and said, hey, we like what you're doing. And like, no shit. Like, without all those voices saying, hey, this is great, I wouldn't be doing this right now. I'd be a contractor and I'd be making lots of money, but I'd be fucking miserable.
Right. You love what you do.
I would be at work all day looking at the clock so I can go home and do this stuff.
Mm-hmm. Now you get to do it full time. So that's
wonderful. Now I'm doing it full time.
That's the dream. That's the dream. So here's the deal, right? So we got probably 20 minutes or so. We usually spend our time with community spotlight. We got a lot to show, but we're going to have to go fast, right, Tony? So we're going to have a speed round of community because we still got a little bit of a wish list. We're going to ask Mark at the end, what kind of contraptions that we want him to do in the future. You saw one Condor, he already did it. So maybe everything we ask him, he's just gonna pull shit out of treasure.
You're gonna go more mask.
Yeah. So here we go.
Yeah, there's Tony, a couple things.
Take us through this one, Tony. No, not that one.
Whoa, what the hell?
That was a spoiler for later.
Power.
Stick around. That's for later. We got to do the community spotlight.
Yes, Jason. Right, this is Jason Crevison. Yeah. He's in the he's in the Joe group, Joe Bashing. That's what Joe Bashing is really like. What you can see the progress of your whips, of your work in progress. And he made himself a jungle squad out of the classifieds. And I thought that was really cool. You know, you see Spirit really cool. Sticks out a lot, and then the rest of them got green berets, and the leader got a hat and a bat.
I do want to give a shout out actually to Jason. I've never met him, but when I was looking up some of this stuff, he is from, I think he's from Weymouth, Massachusetts, or at least he lived there or something. So
he's a big dude. Yeah.
He's a fellow mass hole like myself. So what up, man? Go Sox, go Pats, baby. That's what's nice. Up. So, yeah, fuck the Broncos. Mark doesn't even care. So, all right, here we go. What else are we thinking about this, Tony?
That's Jason and his night squad of Cobras. Yeah. And he differentiated a lot there. And, you know, he took some time to hook it up.
That looks good. That looks dope. Give him
a good shout out. And that's awesome, dude. The color scheme on all those guys.
That looks really good.
Really it's dope. Sharp. Yeah. Sharp black too. Face mask for these damn Vipers and Alley Vipers and bats. And he's just stuck blood in there. It looks really cool.
Yeah.
He did a bunch of stuff. Cool. I gotta spend more time in that group that Joe Bashing, because there's a bunch of badass customizers in there doing some stuff.
Yeah. Rachel asked, might as well answer this, a snake armor? Is that something you would, I was thinking about that today, actually. Would Mark do a snake armor?
So a bunch of people have done snake armors, and we talked about it quite a bit during the stream we did on Saturday with Sean. I'm a big Star Wars guy as well. I've really kind of laid off of collecting that stuff because it was too much for too long. But I for a long time I thought about doing like the 501st. And I'm short and I'm not getting thinner, and I don't really see me doing a lot of like cosplay shit. And I talked to Sean about this, like no kidding, on Saturdays. Like I could do a wearable snake armor and doesn't matter how fucking fat I get, as long as I get like no shit. That's on my radar. Is doing like a wearable snake armor. But there's none. I think Sean definitely did one. He did a snake. There's probably five or six different versions of a classified scale snake armor floating around
out there.
I like some of them are really damn good and slash perfect, so I've never
makes sense. You want to do your own thing, stay in your own lane, it makes sense.
Well, I would rather do something that hasn't been done,
That's what I mean. Yeah, I don't mean stay in your own lane, like you couldn't do it, you would do a great one, but I'm saying, I mean, you just do something that, isn't done three or four times, like you said, so it makes sense. Cool. All right. So getting back to community, this is more of Jason's work.
That's Daniel. That's Daniel Nitta.
Oh, it's Daniel now? We're done, Jason? Mercer? Okay, cool.
Yeah,
Daniel Nitta?
That's Daniel Nitta's Mercer. And I think he doctored some of the Kamakura's head, right? It looks like it.
Yeah, it looks like it.
Yeah. You got some Marvel Legends arms. Those arms are huge.
Yeah. You're massive.
It's a big... Yeah, that Overkill, I think.
Yeah, that's
Overkill. Awesome. That bat is insane. There's like some cybernetics going on.
Mm-hmm.
That looks crazy.
Looks like they did like some dry brushing maybe to make it look.
Yeah, it looks like to make that metal pop.
Yeah, that looks really good.
That worn
RoboCop. Overkill. Yeah, it's crazy.
That's crazy.
There's another good look.
That Roblox gun on the hand there.
Yeah, Roblox tuning fork.
And cool.
Put to good use.
Well done, dude.
That's taking trash and making it treasure there.
Exactly. Daniel Nitta. He's in Joe Bashing too. And
there you go.
Good work. Oh man, and that what do you call it? It's the leader for the Night Creepers, I think.
It's like a Tiger Force Night Creeper.
Yeah, like a Tiger Force, like a Tiger Force Night Creeper.
Well, what were those ninjas? There was like Nunchuck and
Those
Slice and Dice and all those guys. Yeah,
it reminds
Dice and Chabang and
Ninja
Force Fools.
Ninja Tiger Force kind of thing. Yeah.
Sure. They're doing a Ninja Python Patrol. That's the thing.
Yeah, and that would with Vipra. Yeah, you nailed it. You have Vipra from that. So yeah, so that's cool. All black, everything, baby.
All black and
I like the red in the visor there. That's cool.
Yeah,
that's a nice
Cylon. Like a Cylon in there.
Yeah. Nice.
Budo.
Yeah.
I see some. That's some Boosh. Some Boosh stuff in there.
Bushido.
Budo.
That was Bushido. Okay.
Maybe. I don't know. That's the code.
Night Creeper Leader.
Aleph or something? A-L-E-P-H. Snake Eyes, bro. Snake Eyes Vietnam.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sick. That looks like Channing Tatum or something. I don't know. Just saying. And then you get...
You got Lieutenant Stone, I think he calls him. Yeah.
Very cool. And then the final one, I think, is Viking Custom right here, right? Viking Custom Viking 11.
Customs, custom rock and roll.
Mm-hmm. So, kind of the V2 rock and roll.
Right, and that's a.
I did those twin Gatling guns for that shit like 2 or 3 years ago now, and I.
Oh yeah, you did for rock and roll.
I've got a shitload of them. And but like the ammo belts that I made, like the materials I've tried, like either they're bendy and nice and they don't hold the paint, or they hold the paint but they're kind of keen to breaking and
brittle.
Yeah, they get brittle. So I haven't sold them in forever, and I get at least once a week somebody asks me like when I'm gonna have them again. I'm always like, I gotta find the right material for those ammo belts because. I don't like the idea of sending something out that I'm not confident with.
Right.
But I'm sitting on like a shitload of those fucking guns.
There's Navy SEAL shipwreck. That blue looks pretty dope like that. Yeah, almost like too much like a Cobra. But
it's almost too much Cobra, but maybe that's the point. He's like undercover.
Yeah, it looks. Yeah, he can sneak in.
Yeah.
That looks dope. It looks more or less SeaWorld-ish like Torpedo. what's this dude's name? I forgot. You guys know. I probably was out of
Cutter. Because I don't know. The Cutter didn't really have like a.
No, it wasn't Cutter. It's Topside. Topside.
Cool.
That's first class officer.
Very cool. These are great picks, man.
Tiger Force. Doc Stalker.
Stalker.
Mm-hmm. Stalker.
The one way to make Lieutenant Falcon look better, just paint him green.
Just paint him green.
Paint him up,
very
baby.
Cool. And then this was the last image you sent me.
Yeah.
Like an Iron Blood bat.
It's the red bat. Yeah.
Yeah, Iron Blood. Yeah, I like that. Cool. And then here's his. The other guys were on Facebook, but I found his Instagram. So
yeah, the other guys were on JoeFest.
And Viking Custom followed us when I followed him. So go check him out, man. He's got some great work. Awesome.
Red, white, and blue Gatling gun.
What was that?
Oh, I know. Yeah, the one with... red,
blue gun.
The one with Hulk Hogan right next to rock and roll. It shoots firecrackers. It shoots fireworks.
Red Shadow's bat. Yeah.
Red Shadow's bat. Damn it. Yeah, thank you,
yeah.
KJ.
Yeah, very cool. Very cool. All right. And then I got a quick.
Fairy the Workaholic.
Yeah. Fairy, we've had him on. We haven't had him on as a guest, but we've spotlighted him.
We showcased him.
He paints like a mother effer, man. He's every 10 minutes I'm on Instagram. There's a new paint, and it's mine. They all blow me away. Like they're mind blowing work.
Huh? Probably had like 44.
This one's been. Yep, that storm shadow has popped up on every feed that I have this week. Oh,
yeah. it's like my favorite Storm Shadow. It's probably my favorite G.I. Joe figure ever, right? Yeah. And then here it is. He's done it to perfection. Yeah. It's got to be like, if I were to just pick one, yeah, it would be him. And
man, I don't know. I attempted to freehand paint those straight camo lines, because you know how Repeater has them too.
Yeah,
he has them too. But is it
painted? Do you think are those painted or is that like a water?
I don't know if those are painted or stickers, but I think they might be painted. What I did, if I was crooked on them, I just go back in white or tan and make it straight.
Yeah, it's very well done though.
Yeah,
and I don't know. I don't know if he did a wash, but like you can see.
I think he did.
That texture you can see coming across. He's dry brushed onto the texture. Yeah. Kind of pop. It's really nice.
Mm-hmm. This is everything he worked on in the last week, he said, in his image.
So everything he worked on like 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, he works fast. He paints fast and it's
down.
Yeah, look at this. Night Force. Glow with Falcon. Jay and Scarlet.
Are those the eyes that they came with?
I think those are the eyes they came with. He might have whitened them up, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, because they're white, right? But I mean, it's white. Yeah. It's cool. It's
Eyes are hard, man.
I tell these guys I got to get my 40-year-old virgin goggles out to do eyes.
He did a Dallas Cowboy Night Force Scarlet.
I can only wear those glasses for like an hour and then my eyes.
Yeah, I know, dude. They're rough. They're it's rough times with that.
That's true.
He did an onslaught of Valley Vipers, which is, I mean, yeah, look, it's like a Black Ops. Black Ops Valley Viper, and then you get this gold military, you know, the greens. OD with the gold. It's crazy. Yeah,
very crazy.
All black visor. And then
one of my favorite ones, the red and black one.
His tank Alley Viper, right? So the 788 fire team Alley Viper, I guess you would call it. Yeah. And then, you know,
straight urban blue and black.
Nuts. Yeah, urban. Mm-hmm. Kind of
televised. Just don't pay attention to the magazine in backwards, he said.
I wasn't getting you shot too, huh?
Not this one. But
Not that one.
Yeah. Yeah, this is like a python.
The poor
python
guy. Patrol he painted his ass off, and all you can do is point out.
Freaking internet, man. Internet ruins everything. But yeah, and this was the final one. Iron Grenadier's oil. So, it's amazing. This guy just continues to blow me away. So, but everyone's here for this. Everyone's here for this.
What is that about? That's crazy.
Yeah. So KJ wants you to do a helmet for Captain Power.
I don't even know what that is.
Yeah. What do you think about that? Is that something you would?
You guys don't remember Captain Power?
I don't remember Captain Power at all.
I don't. I was like, what the hell is this? But okay, it looks fun and cool.
It's real dated if you watch it now. But when that shit aired, it was amazeballs.
Really? Like
it was very, very early CGI. There was this, one of the bad guys was this, flying robot lizard guy. He was, like, very chrome wings and, like a long beak-like thing and a tail. Yeah, but, like, so the toys, you could shoot light at the TV while watching the show. And score points, but the show could shoot back at you and like blow up your ship.
That's crazy.
Oh my god.
Like when that was airing, it was amazing. It's extremely like dated now. But
a few steps after Megaforce.
That's awesome.
Babylon 5 level storytelling.
Yeah, it was a great show. It was a really great show.
That is one of the guys, I never heard of this.
Oh man, it's worth checking out, man. It's pretty cool. It didn't last very long. There weren't that many figures, but it was fantastic. I would 100% make anything from that show.
Wow, I gotta check this out.
There you go. There's your wish list. Might come true, KJ. And then he had another one. There you go. You know what that is, right?
Oh, yeah. No, I've I haven't seen anyone do it yet, which is kind of surprises me. It's definitely on my radar. It's 100% on my radar.
We're at three for three so far. You did one. Oh, what was that, Tony?
Oh, Von Cannon with his mashups. That's right up his alley.
Hey, yeah, there you go. Well, there's going to be a race between
$300 the fifth
element. I watched that movie like last week, man. I love that movie.
Oh, awesome. Cool. All right. And then this is from Bobby, which we already, his dream already came true. It already happened. But is that a file that you have of Condor?
It's not done. It's not done. Okay. I've got the, I've made it pretty close to the original and scaled it up.
Yeah, we could show that again.
When you scale this up, so it's a motorcycle, right?
Yeah.
And if any of you have ever ridden a motorcycle, you know they're not that wide. And you don't sit in it like it's a scooter.
Like it's a scooter.
I got it pretty close to done and started really questioning whether I wanted to keep it, no kidding, just like this, or try and update it a little bit. Because like scaled up, it's goofy looking. It's real
right.
goofy. And when you take a like a high-end 6-inch figure and put it next to this at that point, it's real goofy looking.
And he's sitting in it with his legs together and everything.
But this toy was made in the 80s with 80s technology to do what it does. But if you go and you watch the cartoon, it doesn't really look exactly like this. It looks more motorcycle like in the cartoon.
Right.
And then like that part right there, I hate that fucking thing. Like I want mine to have an actual like headlight lens that flips up. It's definitely not done. I don't know. I'm not going to make multiple versions. I'm going to make one version and it's going to be the version I'm happy with. But I've got a couple other projects I really need to finish before I even get back to work on this.
Right.
So I'm doing this. This is for my Patreon. That's what I'm doing this for.
There you go. Bobby, get on that Patreon.
Bobby, get on that Patreon, bro.
And you got the Gator here. His other request. Gator.
I had that bad boy.
Somebody, I think I saw it in the G.I. Joe 3D printing group. Someone made a vamp version of the Gator, and it is awesome. It is fucking awesome. It's the Gator, but it's a vamp. Like it's, and they did something else too. Shit. I don't remember. They did another one.
I would just tell Bobby, wait for the vamp because you're going to get it cheaper because it's come from mass retail, and then have it painted if you can't paint it yourself. You know, that's all. I mean, that would be.
Oh, that's what it was. So it opens up and like a boat comes out. That's what
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
We made the boat a devilfish. So it's a vamp that does this and a devilfish.
Oh, that's insane.
That's crazy. Dude,
it's awesome. It's awesome. I wish I could tell you the guy's name. Am I able to share screen if I pull it up?
I think so.
On your camera, I think. Yeah.
You should be able to. Yeah.
I'm looking for it.
Do you see a present option? If you see a present option, you should. We've had guests do it. We've had Carson do it and Mark Von Cannon do it, I think. I could be wrong, but.
Let me. What was this dude's name? I forgot this the character.
I don't know. Mask.
Oh man, I only remember.
That's not Hondo.
Vehicle names, but the guys. I only remember like a couple of the names.
The chat knows. Johnny knows.
Uh-huh. Present. So I have to hit share screen. Sorry.
No, Hondo was the black kid. Damn it.
While you do that, you can answer my question about the armadillo.
So that's the Slaughter Marauder version with those rockets.
And there's also this one, but yeah, the Slaughter Marauder version looks
done. Cool. But it's definitely a medium vehicle. It's very doable. It's very doable. And I'm pretty sure someone's done one. And honestly, no kidding. Like I, I'm curious if Barbecue becomes the only, what are they calling them, the Mad Marauders? If he's the only one of those we get.
Marauders.
Right, but like
we only got Barbecue.
Barbecue is a Mad Marauder, not a Slaughter Marauder.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? But so yeah, just like I started doing, there's only three vehicles that are Python Patrol, and it's the Conquest, the Asp, and the thing that splits in the front. It's ridiculous. I can never think of the name of that damn thing.
Oh, the vehicle?
Yeah.
Oh, the Cobra Stun?
The Stun. So those are the three Python Patrol cannon vehicles, right? The Stun, the Asp, and that thing. Slaughter's Marauders had this, and then they had a couple other mix-matchy, like two or three other vehicles, and they're all great. They're all great. So in my head, if they start actually rolling out Mad Marauders, this would be the first vehicle that I want to do for those.
Armadillo. Oh, yeah. Nice. That's great to know. There you go. So we're getting all our wishes granted here. And then the last one was Tony wanted some JL. He's way left. We're getting away from G.I. Joe. He's
going to hell with it. Let's do some because they're so small. They're doable. The superpowers accessories. Cosmic treadmill time.
Yeah, I'm not doing that.
Not military.
And it's funny. And then he wanted the table for the JLA.
Table and chairs for my. Anybody could do that though. Table and chairs. Table and chairs for your superpowers and whatever. They're only like what? How tall are they? They're not even 1/18. They're 4 inches, I think. The scale.
Yeah, that's.
That's a huge table.
That's 20 minutes of design.
Nothing. Yeah. See, easy.
Like, too easy, bro. All right, so we got the. Here we go.
So there it is.
Yeah. Looks like. There it is.
Oh yeah, that's not just a repaint of a vamp. That's a whole transforming. Look at this video.
That's crazy.
Oh yeah, just congratulations. Like he came up with that, you know, like
that's an Academy Award right there. That's a gold medal right there.
Pretty cool, but just brilliant.
Yeah. But how awesome was that? We had a wish list, and you're either thinking you want to make it, you're gonna make it, or you found friends who've made it, and you're
all over it.
So you've answered everything. Like, you weren't just like
DC universe thing that I just don't care about. Like, sorry.
Yeah, the DC stuff didn't fly. Sorry, Tony. But
I had to put something.
But hey, man. Different. I mean, I guess the only thing we should ask is what's next that maybe you haven't touched upon? You know, it seems like you did cover a lot of things that you got in the warehouse, but is there anything we missed that maybe you just got your sights set on that you're ready to do? If you want to give us any kind of exclusive, but if you don't have to, you don't want to.
I'll say it. So I'm at the beginning of what I hope is a relatively long career. You know, I'm still just getting into the industry.
It's just a baby.
I have a lot to learn. I really want to get into doing figures and doing more, organic designs. And, you know, a big part of why I'm doing the head scans and doing that stuff for people is because it forces me to spend time in ZBrush. ZBrush is a monster to learn. And it just takes time. It just takes time and practice. And you're not going to see much from me with that. My hard surface modeling, I think, is there. I think I within the toy industry, the level of professionalism and detail that's expected, I think I can perform at that level very well. My organic modeling is not there yet, and I don't want to turn people off to me by showing whips. You know, my progress as I'm learning, I don't think that's a good idea. So once I'm there, hopefully in the next year or so, you'll start seeing that kind of stuff from me. I love sculpting. I love doing this stuff, but I think to really be successful business-wise, what I have to do is license an IP. And so that's, at some point in the hopefully not terribly distant future, that's where I'm looking to go, is get a license and have some more manufacturing done.
Right. And I think that's maybe where this comes in, right? Mark2Toys.
Yeah, Mark2Toys. This was a interesting experiment. Like, so Mark2Toys, the plan was that would be the manufacturing side of what I do. Mark2Design is me doing freelance design work and 3D printing and that kind of stuff. And I really wanted, I didn't want people to think the weapon sets that I had manufactured at great expense were 3D printed in my garage. Like I wanted to separate the two. And what I succeeded in doing was just confusing the shit out of everybody. So
you double branded yourself though. That's brilliant. You are two people. You're just like, it's more out there.
I guess. So, but yes, you can go to mark2toys.com. You can get the weapon sets. They're still up on Big Bad Toy Store and a couple other places. So, yeah, you can see a couple examples of them there. They're great. Buy them, please.
Go get you some. And then also the other Instagram is Mark2Design, which is all the funky retro stuff that you're doing on Etsy, all the stuff we love that, you know, kind of drives us to your product. And then hopefully people will come here and then discover that you're doing some, like you said, your own IP, your own brand. And it's one to be reckoned with in the future, for sure. If 2 years you've done all this and you've worked with all these people and you're basically, like you said, you're by yourself on this. You're a one man army. You're working with other people, but I'm saying your company, it's just you. So it's going to take more time for you you've done all this in 2 years, but because it's just yourself. So I think it's great progress.
I'm very proud of what I've been able to accomplish in really what's a pretty short amount of time, you know. I'm self-taught with the 3D design. There's no way I'm going back to school at my age. So that's what I get. But you know, the more I do, the better I get, and I'm enjoying it. I'm having fun. So
mm-hmm. Yeah. And then you have your 3D printing podcast, which you talked about earlier in the show, and then you're gonna have that live printing design studio with the Manta. So that's gonna be a lot of fun, you know. Yeah. Being able to see it from the groundwork up, him and some others creating a vehicle. So go check that out. Mark2Design. Go find him on YouTube. Then,
Because when I stream those streams, I do it through the Mark2Design, but it's really primarily meant to be the GI Joe 3D printing group. So that's a whole other thing, but it's
Facebook
twice, kind of. Yeah. Like, you can watch it on Facebook, you can watch it on Twitch, you can watch it on YouTube, you can watch it on another YouTube channel. So it's out there. That's why we get numbers like those 31 views I had.
But you'll get, I'm pretty sure you'll get some big views for the Manta.
Well, actually, you know, on the GI Joe 3D printing page, it's probably like another 30. So there you go.
Well, you got double the trouble. It's Mark2Design, Mark2Toys, and you can watch stuff on two formats. So we can't even say we do that. We just got one. So Mark2Design is at Etsy. This is very important. This is all the cool stuff that we showed off. I was having such a good time chatting, I forgot to show this off. I mean, this is where you get, you know, your helmets. And this is like, right, this is kind of when I first started discovering your stuff after Action Force and the weapons you made for Bobby Vala. But it was like, this is the stuff I started saying, oh, he's got his own thing going on. And, you know, that was, I do very few customs, but, you know, that was one I was proud of, thanks to the work that you've had, that you've done for Etsy. So there's a lot of cool stuff there.
Thanks.
You got it, man. Anything else you got for him, Tony, before we let him go?
No, man. I just need to grab me some of those EEL loadouts. They look awesome. Oh, that one pistol you got for Valiverse. Is that HK with the suppressor and the laser? It's on the Mark2Design.
Oh yeah, it was. I think, yeah, there was the line art on the Instagram. Is it SOCOM? SOCOM.
All right. So it's not an HK. It's just SOCOM.
Correct. It's a super interesting gun. Like, the SEALs wanted a gun that did. It has to do these six things.
Yes.
And so they, yeah, It's like the actual no shit real gun is, it's a very interesting piece.
Yeah, the suppressor and the weapon light. And, oh my god, yeah.
All of nice. And then Genghis helped us out from the sidelines here. Three at G.I. Joe 3D printing. So go follow them and check that out. And and then have a pool party, I guess. Is that what's happening next at Mark2Design? We're gonna go to Denver, Colorado and have a pool party, I guess. It is summertime.
We may go to Detroit with Punk.
Yeah, cool. Well, I have a pool, so you're welcome to it anytime. If you're
here
in California, if you're here for Comic-Con, you're here for LA Comic-Con.
I'm going to try and get to San Diego Comic-Con next year. I got to, like, yeah.
Let's do it, Moody. Let's go.
Yeah. That's right. I'll always be there. But we hope to be at Assembly Required. I mean, I don't know. Is it too late for, like, registration and hotels and all? Is it full like JoeFest gets?
So the hotel might get tricky. I still need to do that. There's a concert in town the same weekend. I want to say it's like Shania Twain or something. So the hotel may get booked. So yeah, if don't waste time on that. You got plenty of time to register for the show. But actually, the show's free except for I think Friday night they do like an early bird thing. But Saturday it's free. But yeah, hotels might get tight.
Cool. Nice. Yeah, I wanted to go last year, so hopefully, you know, if I can get some of the group to go, I'd love to. I'd love to, and then we'll definitely have to have a pint or two or six or eight.
It's they've got like a regular kind of thing there. Like Saturday night they go out, there's a restaurant in town called Zombie Burger. It's fantastic, but like pretty much everyone from this con shows up at this restaurant.
It's awesome.
Yeah, it is a great time. It's a great time.
Awesome. Oh, you got me sold. So hopefully I'll be there. But you got me sold on a lot of your products, and I can't wait to get the EEL retro vintage set myself and show that off on the gram. But Mark, dude, this was amazing. 2 hours, awesome conversation, man. Thank you for finally hitting the Terror Drome, baby. We here. Yeah,
anytime.
Cool, man. Well, hey, for Tony Romo, I'm Travis Moody, Mark2Design, aka a million things. It's Mark Gerwig, but yeah, we'll see you guys later in the toy aisle. And welcome to the Terror Drome, baby. Peace.